Good evening. You're watching Left, Right and Center. I'm Nithi Razdan. We've got a packed show for you tonight. First, a dramatic twist to the political battle in Uttarakhand. The High Court has ordered a floor test on Thursday. Did the center rush in to impose president's rule or was there no other option? Also tonight, as Pakistan's investigation team visits Pathankot, the Pakistani government has released a so-called confessional video of the Indian man that they have arrested for spying. India has rubbished the claim, but the question is whether Pakistan is trying to deflect from Masood Azhar and from Pathankot. That debate coming up in just a little while from now. But first, in yet another twist to the political drama in Uttarakhand, the High Court today ordered a floor test that will take place on Thursday to determine who has the numbers to form the government. Now, this comes after president's rule was imposed by the centre in the state on Sunday. Significantly, the rebel Congress MLAs who were disqualified, that's nine of them, over the weekend have also been allowed to vote. The centre is likely to challenge the order in the Supreme Court. Harish Rawat, who had challenged the dismissal of his government today, said the High Court order for the floor test was a setback to the centre. Right, well, we'll be joined shortly by senior Supreme Court advocate Dushyant Dave and Sambit Patra of the BJP. Here with us in the studio is the Congress's spokesperson, Tom Vadakkan. Mr. Vadakkan, this could actually go either way. How is the Congress already claiming this, as a victory? Because you don't know what's going to happen in the floor test on Thursday, especially if these rebel MLAs are allowed to vote.
See, essentially, the court has said that they are permitted to vote, A. B, but the finer print is that their vote will be kept separate and a final call will be taken, a judicious call will be taken subsequently. Now, the bottom line is this whole business of what started off as horse trading. They've accused us of horse trading, but we are the victims. So we couldn't be in real terms called horse trading. The story of the horse begins with the horse beating, from there to horse trading to manufacturing a video, what have you. And what is the FSL report saying on the video? The video report says prima facie. Now, point is, when you give something to a laboratory for a test, they either say, yes, this is fabricated, or it is not. Now, here is one FSL report, forensic report at that, which is hanging midway, which doesn't say anything. Okay, that being...
Prima facie says a lot. If it says prima facie...
That is... I can look at a tape and say prima facie, it looks to me... okay.
Yeah.
You don't need to send it to a forensic lab. A forensic lab says yes
but
or
my
no.
My point to you is simple. If these nine Congress rebel MLAs who have openly revolted against the party, now that they're going to vote in the floor test, actually that makes the situation for Harish Rawat a little precarious.
On the contrary, if the votes are taken and they are kept aside, as the judiciary has said, then there's a world of opportunity in this. And the important thing is, this is a strange poetic justice being done. Here's nemesis catching up. You've decided that all governments that are opposed to you, whether it's Congress, any center, left, right, center parties, all go. You have a federal structure coming in. And what is all this game plan about? This is not just that... through the back door, you drop a government and you have governors. That's not the
issue. You're talking
about the Rajya Sabha number.
But, you know, before I come to Sambit on this, Dushyant Dave, we really need you to explain to us how to understand the High Court's order today. Because the state is under president's rule and yet you have a floor test that has been ordered as well on Thursday. How does that work exactly?
Well, it's now well settled that any presidential proclamation is subject to judicial review. Right from Bomai's case, this law is very clear. The High Court has looked at the facts, I'm sure, and has come to a conclusion that really presidential proclamation perhaps didn't have the kind of supporting material which it needed. And the court therefore felt that it would be absolutely justified, you know, that floor test, which is the real test, even as per Bomai's judgment, is ordered, and that's what exactly what the governor had himself directed. So I personally feel that there is no conflict between the presidential rule and the High Court's order today. If the High Court's order is implemented, ultimately the presidential rule can always be set aside by the High Court, and government can always be restored back. That power judiciary always retains. So I think it's an eminently just order that the High Court has passed today.
So you're saying, so who's in charge in Uttarakhand right now? The president's rule is still there. That's what I wanted clarity on. And yet you will, as you said, you know, the court is well within its right to order a floor test as well, because as you say, they were obviously not satisfied with the proclamation of central rule.
Well, president's rule is definitely in force, but it doesn't conflict with this order. So the two can exist side by side. And ultimately, after the floor test result comes and when the court really, you know, examines it, the court will pass appropriate further orders, including for restoration of the government and revival of the assembly, which the court has absolute power to do.
So, Sambit Patra, is this not an embarrassment or a setback for the Centenary, the fact that the High Court has ordered this floor test?
First and foremost, you have to understand the, in fact, the intricacies of this whole case. Number one, as rightly pointed out by Mr. Dave, the court has all the rights as per the S.I. Bumai case. The court has the right that if the court sees any kind of malafide intention in imposing the precedent rule, then the High Court or the Supreme Court, as per the Bumai's case, the High Court or the Supreme Court can set aside the precedent's rule. But in this particular case, as everyone agrees, the president's rule has not been set aside. That means there is no malafide or erroneous intention of the central government, which we are questioning right now. Secondly, as far as the Congress is concerned, what did the Congress go to the court for? The Congress went to the court for two things. Number one, revoke the president's rule. Number two, let the disqualification of the member of legislative assemblies, nine of them, continue. They did not achieve either. One, the president rule was not revoked. Secondly, the disqualification, those stays, but still these people will have the right to vote. So in a way, the High Court has revisited to March 18th, which was the point of contention. Our point was the murder of democracy took place on the floor of the Legislative Assembly on March 18th because the appropriation bill could not be passed. There were nine people who wanted division of votes. But the Speaker did not concede to it, did not agree
but
to it.
But then should you have waited for the floor test that the Governor asked for on the 28th, which was just yesterday? I mean, now we have the same situation except that it's happening a couple of days later.
See,
instead of rushing for President's rule, should there just have been a floor test yesterday?
I'm going to answer this, but with a caveat. Number one, none of us, I mean, the three panelists that we are, and I think even you, Nidhi, have gone through the finer prints of the verdict of the court as yet, because I think it is not available as of now. Secondly, the legal team of the Bharatiya Janata Party will also go through the finer prints and thereafter decide whether to appeal at a higher place or not, which I would wait. But having said this, as far as your question is concerned, that would it have been better on our part to wait for the floor test to take place on 28th and thereafter imposed or not imposed the president's rule? I would say, look, when the president's rule was imposed, only when there was a question on the disqualification of the member of legislative assemblies, nine of them to be precise. The moment the speaker announced that these people are disqualified, the question arose was, if a whip, because disqualification can only take place when a whip is set aside by these dissents. If there was a whip to which the nine of them dissented, that is, the whip was on 18th of March.
That means the finance bill was not passed.
Exactly. That means the government never existed.
Yeah, and that is an important point. And I want to get Mr. Dave back on that, because Mr. Dave, the questions are not just being raised on the issue of president's rule, but also about the speaker's conduct and whether it was, whether the speaker was, you know, perhaps out of line in disqualifying these MLAs. And, there are question marks being raised on this as well. How do you see it? Even though the speaker is supposed to be the master of the house, had the speaker, by disqualifying them, effectively then rendered that appropriations bill to not have gone through on the 18th, which means that the government, doesn't exist?
Well, these are all really grey areas. There is no doubt that speaker is the master of the house, and his conduct is really, something which can certainly be gone into before a competent court of law. But how he conducts the proceedings, what he really sees, is really within the realm of the speaker. And I'm sure, what really has transpired in Nagaland, Manipur, Arunachal Pradesh, will tell us that Speaker's ultimate authority is held to be absolutely, you know, supreme. But in the facts of the case, there is no doubt about the fact that, I mean, whether the, you know, the bill was passed on the floor of the assembly or not is a very, very debatable question. What transpired there is, you know, absolutely in grey area. But there is one fact that the Speaker is justified on a complaint of the Congress party to take appropriate action against this rebel MLAs. The whole purpose of the 9th schedule is to prevent this kind of a, you know, I would say dishonest attempt on the part of a group of MLAs or MPs to walk away from the party on the strength of whom they have been elected.
But and wouldn't they have to defy a whip for that? Wouldn't they have to defy a whip for that? Wouldn't they have to defy a party whip for that action to take place?
You know, it's, you know, the expression used is directive in the 9th schedule. And any kind of a directive would be included. It's again a very grey area. But the fact of the matter is that if these MLAs have publicly joined the BJP MLAs, paraded themselves before the governor and before the press, then I think it's sufficient material for the Speaker to come to the conclusion that they have certainly walked away from the party, and Speaker would be entitled, because ultimate idea is to ensure that democratic principles are, you know, ensured and that they are kept intact. And you know what is really troublesome, Nidhi, is something much more. One point.
Yeah.
That BJP, you know, is a party which, I mean, I don't agree with their philosophy, but I respect them, because they really came to power with a promise to provide a better governance. Congress party had its own pitfalls, we all attacked it. But, you know, to touch a man like Mr. Bahuguna, who had left the judiciary in extremely suspicious circumstances by the BJP, is something which really is disturbing for those of us who are connected to the judicial system.
I'll
let Sambit respond and then get Mr. Vadakkan in on that. Sambit, on, you know, on the legal points, clearly there are a lot of grey areas. And Sambit, you were on the program yesterday. Mr. Soli Sarabji had a point of view that there was a question of impropriety perhaps in imposing president's rule a day before a trust vote, but he didn't believe that it was illegal in any way and that the government was well within its rights to do that. Dushyant Dave points out that there are a lot of grey areas. No one can say with certainty what happened on the 18th of March on the floor of the House. Under those circumstances, Sambit, you know, was the centre really rushing in to impose president's rule because you knew that if those MLAs are disqualified, then Harish Rawat would win that trust vote on Monday?
I'll give a technical answer as well as a political answer, following the technical answer, because both are required over here. First and foremost, with all due respect to Dushyant Daveji, whom we all respect a lot, I would say, after all, law is not all that grey that he's projecting it to be. Law is black and white, but it's not all that grey. Well, as far as what happened on March 18th is concerned, if Mr. Dushyant Dave, who is a renowned judicial personality, himself say that no one knows what transpired on the floor of the Legislative Assembly, I believe this is itself meaning that there was breach of the constitution, because constitutionality has to be absolutely transparent. A constitutionality where no one knows what happened is what is, I would say, something where the constitutionality has been breached. Secondly, I have been extremely mathematical in explaining that what you are calling as a directive. Well, yes, a whip is nothing but a directive. If there was a directive by the party, which in fact has been rendered low by the MLAs of the party, then surely the Speaker, as the master of the house, can move ahead and can disqualify them. But if he does so, naturally, the appropriation bill falls. This is a very mathematical explanation. There is nothing grey in it. Thirdly, a political explanation as to BJP's role in the political system of Uttarakhand. Look, the marketplace where the selling and buying of the MLAs was taking place belonged to the Congress. The one who was selling, the one who was buying, both were congressmen. What is the role of the Bharatiya Janata Party over here? I was listening to the Congress spokesperson, my friend Tom Vadakkan, when he was questioning the authenticity of the CD. My question to Mr. Vadakkan right now is, Tom, tell me, if you had any suspicion about the CD, as you were said in the first day that it's a Farji CD, is there an FIR against the CD? The logical thing would have been, you should have lodged an FIR against the CD. The logical thing would have been, Mr. Harish Rawat, as the chief minister then, when the CD appeared, he would have ordered a CBI probe, because he would have wanted the people who were conspiring against him to malign him to be behind the bar.
I want to take that to Mr. Vadakkan, and also the question about what you know, the Congress is taking away from this. Because when you have people like Mr. Bahuguna and other leaders in the Congress party, whether it's been in Assam and elsewhere, you know, this whole issue of rebellion within the Congress, why is this happening to the Congress party? Why is everybody saying that Sonia Gandhi is inaccessible, Rahul Gandhi is inaccessible, we've tried to meet them for 2 years, you're trying to placate rebels in Manipur. So, you know, is there a problem that you have with the high command?
No, it's not the problem with the high command. This is a standard script of those who align with the Bharatiya Janata Party with tons of money that they pass on. This is the standard script that is read out. You blame Rahul Gandhi, you blame Mrs. Gandhi, you say there is no leadership, there is all that. Standard bullshit. We've heard that often. They do this huge money, you know, the money that was, black money that was to come into India.
So they've all been paid off by the BJP.
It's a total payoff.
But then you're in denial about the problems within
your
party.
Now, let me complete this. There was some talk about law not being grey. I must tell our honourable spokesman from the Bharatiya Janata Party, I agree, law is black and white. But the grey acts come in when the Bharatiya Janata Party contrives a situation in Uttarakhand, while the similar situation is practiced in Maharashtra and it's perfectly justified. Fadnavis faced a voice vote by the speaker, and today he is still the chief minister of Maharashtra. By the same law, which you say is grey, blue or whatever, isn't that man a pretender to the chief ministership of Maharashtra? Rule applies for you in Maharashtra, there's one rule, and in Uttarakhand there's another rule. Why are you jumping into the Supreme Court in such a hurry? If you are confident of your people, you're confident of winning the floor, I don't think there's any question.